am here with Maria Cardona. Now, this is a big moment for me interviewing somebody like you. So again, thank you so much for coming.
Oh, you're so sweet, Vampy. Thank you.
No. Actually, I am. But don't tell anybody because it's going to ruin everything. Now, before we get to the meat and potatoes, I've got to tell you, Maria, I'm reading your bio. Well, I'm trying to. I've been doing it for 4.5 hours and I'm still in the first paragraph. CNN in Espanol, you're a political analyst, you're an advocate for this, for that, for the other thing, for so many things helping Latinos. Mm-hmm. It's like the only thing that's missing here is like Spanish speaking Wonder Woman. I mean, you've done everything and you do so much. Where did this come from? This incredible career, this drive, this desire to be somebody who's making such an impact.
Well, first of all, Vamp, thank you. Gracias for having me on. I have been very lucky my whole life to have been, you know, this sounds like a cliche, but this is actually very true, at the right place, at the right time, but also instilled with the values that both of my parents instilled in me growing up. When I was looking for an entry-level job here in D.C., I was introduced to somebody who worked at the Democratic National Committee. That person knew that the Democratic National Committee was looking for somebody to, in their communications office, to reach out to Hispanic press. And it was the very first time they had ever had that position. It was the first time that the Democratic Party was ever doing anything like that. The chairman of the Democratic Party at the time, who had just been elected, was a trailblazing African-American man by the name of Ron Brown. And he knew, he sort of saw it in the stars that the Latino community was going to become incredibly important politically. And he wanted to be the party that was speaking to them in their language, that was communicating with them where they were. And so they hired me to do Hispanic press outreach, both Spanish language as well as English language. And that was the first time that a major party committee did anything like that. So that put me on the path of politics. I started getting involved in all of the issues. I started understanding the personal connection that there is between policy, politics, and people's lives. And it was very eye-opening to me because I also saw the numbers that were growing. The numbers that would tell us what we know today, that the Latino community is incredibly important politically, that in 20 years, a third of America is going to be of Hispanic descent, that we are in 50 states and growing, and that we're going to be the largest ethnic voting minority in the 2020 elections in November. And so that put me on this path of wanting to ensure that our community became as strong as possible, both from an issue standpoint, from a vocal standpoint, and from understanding what it meant to go vote. Because what was happening back then, and sadly it is still happening today, the Hispanic community still has not completely flexed our muscle to the numbers that we actually own.
But being that there was never anybody to compare yourself to in this position, it was the first time. Is that correct?
Yeah.
So that gave you a little bit of freedom to make mistakes and nobody would understand. Right. So becoming this role model and this person with, I don't want to say power, but responsibility, just because you speak Spanish doesn't mean you're from Mexico. How did you attack that or confront that? Because Dominicans and Puerto Ricans don't really get along. I know that from the Guardian Angels of New York City and the Lower East Side. Trust me, I've been there, seen it, done it every day. Mexico, Northern Mexico doesn't get along with Southern Mexico. Southern Mexico, Northern Mexico doesn't get along with the guys in Los Angeles. How did you come up with a strategy and patience to go there?
That is a great question, Vamp, because one of the challenges that I did face early on in my career, and it still happens today, when I strategize with clients on what to do, is that they do fall into this myth that because we're all Latinos, the strategy to communicate with our community can be cookie cutter and can be one and the same in all 50 states. And you're absolutely right that that is completely wrong. You cannot do that. Mm-hmm. If you do that, you're going to fail. And the reason why a lot of people thought that is because they see Latinos, minority community, the only other experience they had with minority communities were African Americans. And with African Americans, they saw Martin Luther King, they saw Jesse Jackson, they saw the Reverend Al Sharpton. They had one leader that was able to mobilize and energize and inspire majorities of the African American community. That is absolutely not the case with Latinos. Why? Because of exactly what you just mentioned. We are from everywhere. I'm Colombiana. The majority of Latinos in this country currently are from Mexico, but you have a tremendously growing Puerto Rican population, and not just in Orlando. And so what I ended up coming up with mm-hmm. is that you can do a campaign, let's say a political campaign, that can communicate with all of the various groups that candidates and political campaigns, and especially presidential campaigns, need to communicate to, but you have to do it in a targeted way. So for example, if you want to run an ad in Orlando, it can't have the same music, the same accent, the same images that you would if you're running an ad in Los Angeles.
That's phenomenal. So what I admire about that challenge that you had to face was the voting problem. So when I was working in politics in Mexico, like the cartel sure. people would come in and they would put their candidate in office before the elections. And they were like,
yeah.
And I almost feel like the older generation of Latinos who've come to the United States, and I'm only speaking from what I saw, are like, sure. why even vote? It's already determined.
Yeah.
Is that yeah. something, is that fear or is that a cultural thing from these countries?
I think it's a cultural thing from these countries. Mm-hmm. And it is something that political campaigns have got to be aware of. But I also
think... But is it fear? Or is it because they're
why even bother? I think it's more, why bother? But I also believe that while that might be an initial or a first guttural reaction, there's a reason why people come to the United States, right? There's a reason why people risk their lives and very often even lose their lives trying to come here or trying to bring their children here. And it's because they do understand that while no politician, no political party, no society is perfect, the United States, all things being equal, if you work hard and you play by the rules, you will be able to get ahead in a way that you never could in any of the countries that we were from. I think that what you have here is more of a problem of a lack of connection between what voting will mean to people's lives and to the lives of the communities. And people need to have a better understanding of the connection between the decision makers and the policies that they will pass and how that will affect people's everyday lives.
Forget these politicians. Forget about them. I got something else that's more important. We will be right back.